Ladies and gentlemen, this is the last session of the conference, which traditionally is quite a tough session because people have been listening to 2 days of questions, answers, speeches, and so forth. But the issue we're dealing with in this session is in many ways globally the most consequential question in foreign policy this year, which is about where the US sit globally, but of course also critically in the Middle East. And I have a fantastically distinguished, competent, experienced and knowledgeable panel with me, which I think is the biggest panel we've had so far. I have Dr. Nabil Fahmy, who's a former Egyptian foreign minister, and now with the American University of Cairo, Peter Bergen, CNN, and various other things, Susan Glasser from Politico, John Alterman from CSIS, and Ken Pollack, of course, who's been writing about Iraq for longer than almost anybody else in the entire world, certainly modern Iraq. We have limited time because we have been overrunning, so we need to be snappy both in the questions which I'm going to ask and the responses and the questions which you're going to put to the panel, which I know many of you will have. So what I'd like to do is to kick off by talking about what this looks like in Washington at the moment. And I should say I spend my time between the United States and Bahrain at the moment, so I get a sort of ringside seat in two areas of the world where this matters. And I scribbled the questions down on my mobile phone, so I hope you don't mind my looking at this. I'm not tweeting. I'm checking what I need to ask. So there's a couple of questions, really, about Washington, which I wanted to focus on. The first is what does the Trump administration's foreign policy look like a month or so after inauguration? Is there such a thing that you can identify as a Trump doctrine or an emerging Trump doctrine? Are there continuities and discontinuities that we can identify from the Obama administration? And thirdly, the national security team itself. There are some impressive people there. What does that actually look like, and what do we think the prospects are for a unitary view and a unitary execution of policy from this team we have at the moment? And of course, what we think the relationship is and is likely to be between the NSC, state, and the Department of Defense and the White House. So perhaps I could ask Susan to start, and then I'll go to Peter, and then we'll come back to the regional view, and then we'll take it from there.
Well, first of all, thank you so much. I know it's a tough thing to be the last panel after such a distinguished forum already, and I want to thank everybody here, and especially American University, for organizing this great session. On the one hand, it's tempting to make a joke in response to this and say, okay, our work is done here, because the short answer is we don't know yet when it comes to what is the actual Trump foreign policy as opposed to the rhetoric that we've been seeing in the campaign and early on in the presidency. You know, on the one hand, it's fair to say that, you know, we're coming, many of us from Washington, to this gathering, the new source of political instability in the rest of the world, you know, which is an unlikely and at times very uncomfortable position to be in. I was struck, as I'm sure many of you were, by Frank Fukuyama's comments this morning, you know, that he'd never seen anything like this in his lifetime in terms of the challenges to American institutions. And so on the one hand, when you ask, what is the Trump foreign policy, I think it is best understood as a sort of hostile takeover, not only of Washington from the Democratic foreign policy establishment, but largely from the Republican view of the world as well. And so you have a president whose stated views are very much at odds not only with the other party, but are at odds largely with the consensus among the Republican foreign policy elite about the role that America should play in the world. And clearly that has big implications both for the Middle East and more broadly around the world. So my own view is that Trump has some notions about foreign policy, much more so than to speak of a doctrine would be almost absurd, you know, given how informed in policy terms many of those notions are. But he's serious, and he means it when he talks about an America first view of the world. Somehow that's not going to be incompatible with already increasing the amount of American military presence on the ground right next door here in Syria, even though we might be able to identify that as a contradiction. Wiser heads than mine have suggested that maybe we should all just take a break and come back in 6 months, and then we'll have a better sense of, you know, what Trump's foreign policy is. But I do think that it's important not to entirely dismiss what he's saying as a lot of hot air or political rhetoric. Unlike others in Washington, I am of the view that you should pay attention to his tweets and that merely to dismiss it as political theater. I had one very senior Republican former administration official tell me, oh, I tell all the people I talk to, just disregard the Twitter feed and, you know, tune out in 6 months and look at his appointments. I don't think that's quite right, because I believe that Trump's intention is to be very hands-on on the things that he cares about. He's not yet constructed a government that he has full control over, and it's not entirely clear whether these qualified officials such as General Mattis as Defense Secretary or General McMaster as National Security Advisor, they're very experienced people. How much do they matter to Donald Trump? We don't know. We just don't know whether they do or not. So that's a long-winded way of saying, maybe we can all end the conference a little early. But thank you.
But we're not going to.
There's a lot of continuity between George W. Bush's second term and Obama, a lot more than people expected. And in a normal American political dispensation, there would be similar continuities. And I think there are some continuities. But let me just put two caveats. Every American administration is made up of the ideologues and the pragmatists, and we have that in this administration. But we also have somebody who's president who's very mercurial and hard to predict. Now, we saw this play out with the visa ban in a rather perfect controlled experiment, because the pragmatists and the people with experience and expertise, General McMaster, General Mattis, and Secretary Tillerson, all lobbied to make sure that Iraq was not subject to the travel ban. But the travel ban continues to exist. And the travel ban is an absolutely, it's a crazy idea, because it's a solution to a problem that doesn't exist. Every American who's been killed since 9/11 by a jihadi terrorist, it doesn't come from any of these countries, nor does their family. So it's a bit like saying we have a problem in the United States with Central American gangs in our cities, but we're going to ban people from Chile and Argentina and Canada from coming to the United States. It doesn't make any sense. So the ideologues kind of won one part of that, and then the pragmatists won the other. But if we look at the region and say, look at what is actually happening, in Yemen we're seeing a dramatic amping up of the policy. But don't forget that it was Obama, not George W. Bush, that really amped up the war in Yemen. Under George W. Bush, there was only one drone strike in Yemen. Under President Obama, there were at least 125. So it's amping up, but it's a continuation of the Obama policy. Now, the Trump team is going to come out with a new Syria anti-ISIS policy. We saw some of it just today with Marines going to Syria. It will be announced as a very dramatic departure. It's like, you know, Eisenhower and D-Day. But in fact, it will be very similar to what Obama was doing. It'll be special forces. It'll be drones. There may be, you know, very minor changes around this. There's no demand signal from the American public to send in a 50,000-man army, women army, into the Middle East, and all his military commanders are saying that would be a bad idea, whether it's in Iraq or Syria. I think in Saudi Arabia, where there's been a lot of rhetoric against Saudi during the campaign by President Trump, our policy will be very similar to what it is already, which is a relatively close alliance. In Afghanistan, I think there will be a departure from the President Obama approach, which was essentially to constantly saying we're leaving, which I think was enormously counterproductive because the United States isn't going to withdraw from Afghanistan, and constantly saying we're going to withdraw kind of undermine confidence in the government and the investors, added to the confidence of the Taliban. So I do think that we will see an increase of General Nicholson, who's the commander of U.S. forces in Afghanistan, is calling for 2,000 more American advisors. I think that will happen. On Iran, you know, Mattis has already said that the nuclear deal should stay. And so despite the fact there are quite a lot of skeptics of Iran in the National Security Council, I don't think there's going to be a substantive change. So when you take that all together, one other point, I think it's highly unlikely that the Muslim Brotherhood would be designated as a terrorist organization because it's such a bad idea. And so they will walk back from terrible ideas. So if you look at that, I mean, it's really a question for all of us. Is that very different from Obama, despite all the things that have been said? Yes, in, you know, when Trump did the speech to Congress, he said the phrase radical Islamic terrorism. And that was regarded as a great victory by people within the on the ideological side. But does that really make a difference? At the end of the day, these are words. What was actually important was that Iraq was excluded from the travel ban, which is a win on policy.
Thanks, Peter. Dr. Nabil, can I turn to you for the view from the region? I was very struck that when the president came out with what looked like a set of sequentially incoherent statements about moving the U.S. embassy to Jerusalem, that he liked the two-state solution, but he also liked the one-state solution, and probably a three-state solution as well at some point. That's not my idea, by the way. That the Americans, of course, should have taken Iraqi oil, which then Jim Mattis the week later said was a very bad idea. There was very little reaction from the region. I mean, it looked to me as if people were keeping their powder dry. And I also think, and it's a pretty open secret, that many states of the region were not that displeased to see the back of the Obama administration, particularly in the Gulf and this part of the world. How do we make sense of that? What do you think the states of the region, and that's a big question because there's lots of states in this region, would like to see, and what do you think they can realistically expect from a Trump administration?
Okay, let me try to answer that question and also part of what you asked previously. But before I do, I want to really thank Dr. Birhamsala for the very kind invitation. I've never been in this part of the country before, and it's my first time, and the first time at the university also. So I thank you for that. It's been very insightful. I think you need to amend your question a little bit, whether you're talking about a Trump doctrine or a Trump administration doctrine. Fact is, for the Clinton supporters, Trump has been elected, and they have to live with that. For the Trump supporters, Trump has been elected, and he now has to live with the world. So you're going to have to play your role as America in a much larger, complex environment. Now, what does he have for the Middle East, and how does the Middle East look at him? If you look at what he has said in the past, he has no political precedent for us to go back and say, this is what he will probably be doing on the Middle East, per se. What he was clear on is he wants to be a disruptive force. He wants to be different worldwide, including in Washington, by the way. He's very prominent on being anti-extremism, anti-terrorism. He's very negative on Iran. He's very prominent on all over the world, friends and allies. You need to carry more of the share of your role. We will help, but ultimately you will carry more of the share. I think the Arab world is still trying to figure out what he's going to do and consequently what they should do in response. There is both over-enthusiasm and over-pessimism. On the one hand, I'm not sure what they can be enthusiastic about except this issue of extremism, because even on extremism, he said he's against it, and I think that's a positive. But then he's argued that Middle Easterners need to play a much larger role in dealing with that in their area as the same case. And so Where the burden sharing will be is going to be an interesting point. On the issue of Iran, if you want, well, he's on the one hand very negative on Iran, but he's also been speaking like a realist. I need to engage the Russians, and I frankly support that, irrespective that there have been some negative trends of the last couple of days. But you can't deal with Syria without engaging the Russians. So how is he going to square that circle is going to be interesting. I think it's way too early to determine that he's going to be a stand-up guy on a particular issue. But let me just run through a couple of them quickly. Libya, there's no question that in the trend of dealing with extremism, he will probably be supportive for efforts by others in Libya. But I can't imagine, except with a couple of special forces here and there, that he would significantly put any significant effort into the Libyan issue. He could support Algeria, Tunis, and Egypt on what they're doing on the borders and things like that. Peace process in the Middle East, I'm not going to hold my breath. He's shifted so many times on what he likes and what he doesn't like. Even if he has the right to make that shift, there are consequences to the shift. We've seen a jump in Israeli actions, not since he spoke, since he was elected. So, and these are going to make it very difficult for a two-state solution to emerge. I encourage him to engage the Russians and all the other parties on the Syrian issue, but I also encourage him to speak to the Arabs a little bit on Syria as well. Syria is not going to be a happy solution for anybody, but it's going to be a difficult compromise. As you go further than that, the administration in their past, the administration officials in their past records have said things that are different from Trump.
Yeah.
So how you deal with Muslims in defense, national security, they've been much more reasonable in their terminology and how you deal with Muslims. On the issue of Russia, defense looks at Russia as more of an enemy than Trump seems to look at Russia. And we can go on, even on the issue of terrorism, there are different opinions on how you deal with terrorism and how you don't. I think, frankly, this is going to be complicated, it's going to take time. We don't have the luxury of ignoring him. It's the President of America. So we all need to work on how do we have influence in trying to develop that doctrine, which he will develop over time. I'll close by saying two things. And this is something where I see is positive in what Trump is saying. Trump is basically saying the world has to be more responsible for its own challenges, if you want. I think Arabs need to be more responsible for the challenges they face. I think they're over-dependent on foreigners. We should not isolate ourselves, but we need to do more domestically, we need to do more regionally, and engage the world at the same time. Over-dependency is not going to help.
Yeah, okay. Thank you very much. Can I pick up a couple of those points and turn it to John? I'm thinking about Iran. President Obama, of course, famously said that one of the keys to the region was Iran and Saudi Arabia learning to share the region with each other, which didn't happen, and quite honestly, it doesn't look as if it's going to happen anytime soon. But this is a central conundrum at the heart of a lot of the conflicts in very complex ways in the region. The president and those around him, and those formerly around him, like the former national security advisor, have made some public remarks which seem to be to herald a much tougher attitude towards Iran. At the same time, there seem to be signs that the administration is thinking about a more collaborative approach in certain areas with Russia. And yet Russia and Iran have interests which have increasingly converged in the region. So if on the one hand you push back vigorously against Iran, and there are reasons why you'd want to do this, the Iranians are being have upped the level of their provocations in the maritime space, in the Gulf. There was another missile test recently, and so forth. If you're doing that, but also trying to bring Russia onto your side in other areas, in Syria in particular, but maybe also with Turkey in Iraq, how does that all fit together? I'm trying to search for this sort of, for any signs of coherence in this at the moment. I'm thinking about it in terms of that relationship between Iran and Saudi Arabia.
for your generosity and hospitality. And also congratulate you all on the realization of an incredible dream, both in this conference and in the university in which we sit. It's very impressive, and it's a great honor to be here. I mean, what you basically asked is, what's the difference between the policy and the strategy? And that there are any number of policies, and I think there are a lot of reasons to continue the policies we've had, to try to extend them. There are any number of people who feel empowered to continue a policy. How any of this fits into a strategy is a mystery to virtually everybody. And as you point out, you don't get very far before you run into some really fundamental choices. The Obama administration had a strategy that had improving the relationship with Iran as a key goal, with an idea that if you provided a vision for a place Iran could go, that Iran would go there, and then you'd have a whole different strategic environment in the Middle East. The Trump administration seems very skeptical of the idea that you can attract Iran to anything positive, and seems committed to the idea that if you show resolve to the Iranians, they will back off. Then the question quickly becomes, showing resolve to the Iranians means what with regard to the Russians? What with regard to the Saudis? The Saudis are a really hard problem for this administration. Because on the one hand, if you want to be really serious about the Iranians, it's hard to do it without the Saudis being on board. On the other hand, if you're all about counterterrorism and counter-radicalization, and you want to do away with this sort of Salafi ideology and theology throughout the world, it's hard to do it unless you have some partnership with the Saudis, unless you're going to try to beat the Saudis and the Iranians at the same time, and then what happens elsewhere. And it seems to me that this administration has not had to make any hard choices about things it will prioritize and put actual resources into, and things it wants but will have to de-emphasize because other things are more important. We are going to be dealing with a constrained resource environment, especially if you start putting more money into building equipment and building up troop strength and all those things. There's going to be less money to go around. There are going to be things you're not going to be able to do even if you want to do them. You're going to have fewer tools to win over friends. And I think the other piece, and Nabil said this a little bit, if you're trying to help the United States, if you have no idea what the United States is trying to do, it's harder to help them. It's harder to get to that point when you're unsure where the policies go. And I think, I will take Frank Fukuyama's advice about, I'm new here and it's a lot more complicated than I could ever hope to understand, but I would think that here in Iraqi Kurdistan, where you have issues of how do you deal with the Iraqi central government, how do you deal with the Iranians, how do you deal with the Americans, how do you think about the Russians? I mean, all those different priorities and trade-offs become central trade-offs that Kurds have to think about. And I think what you're hearing from this American panel is, we're not sure where this is all going.
Good answer. Ken. Again, picking up on one of John's points about Iraq, which in many ways is the sort of central test. It's a central test for tactics, and it's a central test for strategy or the absence of a strategy, it seems to me. Now, we've actually seen what looks like a pretty robust and successful military strategy in Iraq, with U.S. forces and indeed with Iraqi forces fighting very well and bravely and taking heavy casualties and pushing back Daesh. And yet we know from experience, and you know better than most, that you need a political strategy on top of this. And somebody said to me, we're going back to the issue of the national security team, you have generals or former generals, Mattis, Dunford, Kelly, McMaster, and so forth in there, and then Secretary Tillerson. But you have four former military men who are all extremely competent, extremely experienced, and the rest of it. But somebody once said to me, if you have military men doing the policy, you will get a military policy. And this absence of a political strategy on the top of this, in Iraq has been, of course, one of the things that has led to the situation in which we are now. There's also the added complication, of course, of Syria and how Syria impacts on what's happening in Iraq and where the Turks are, of course, and this whole issue of Iran and Russia. So focusing in on Iraq, what do you make of all of that?
Thanks for handing that one to me, Shager. And first off, thank you to Kak Barham and to the students and faculty of AUIS. It is always such a great honor to be here at the Suli Forum. I think you've got it exactly right, though, JJ. We've got a set of issues in Iraq, tactical, strategic. It's unclear exactly how the administration is going to handle them, right? And I think everyone on the panel has said important things that relate to this. At one level, I'll pick up a point that Peter started to make, and I think it gets to your point about the team that we're looking at. You've got a very competent, very experienced national security team, and the thing that they know best is Iraq. They all fought here one way, shape, or form, Rex Tillerson perhaps in a different fashion. But the military members of the cabinet, they fought here, they bled here, they lost friends here. They are acutely aware of the importance of Iraq, of Kurdistan for that matter, of this entire part of the world. They are exactly, as you put it, JJ, acutely aware that military victories are ephemeral if there is no successful political, economic, social strategy to pin them in place. And I think that part of the struggle that Peter was talking about with regard to the president's stated preferences and the kind of in their bones experience of this national security team, it's going to come out with regard to Iraq. Because what the president said, of course, on the campaign trail is, we got to crush ISIS, we're going to do it fast, right? But no commitment to the region itself. What did he say about Iraq? We're going to steal the oil and go home, right? I can't think of a worse possible way to think about this part of the world. But the people who he has picked to help him make foreign policy believe exactly the opposite. Now, we also have to look at some of the other elements of Washington. He is talking about massively beefing up the military budget. Okay, there's an argument to be made for that, given some of the things he'd like to do. He's also talking about massively cutting the State Department budget. And who has objected most loudly to this? The military. Right? It has been our generals who have been screaming, you cannot do this. Because without the economic and diplomatic and political pieces of this, it's going to account for nothing. Now again, I think that we have a long ways to go. But I think that this is going to be really the critical question. And another piece of news that we've heard recently is that General Mattis is putting together this plan for defeating ISIS and doing it faster, defeating Daesh, excuse me, over here I can use the proper term. But it's really an options memo. It's less a, we're going to do this and that. It's more a, well, we should increase the number of troops. But we can increase the number of troops by 10 or 10,000 or 100,000. And how many would you like to increase it by, Mr. President, to try to suss out exactly what's going on? And I know from my own conversations with folks in the national security establishment, they're trying very hard to figure out what this president is willing to commit to this part of the world, because they understand full well that the military resources alone are not going to do it. So there's your fight over tactics, right? But you're also right, JJ, that there's this wider struggle over strategy. Right? And I think that John's remarks and Nabil's remarks also get to these questions about strategy. And how are we thinking about the region? And in particular, this question that you asked John and his response, I think it's critical. Right? This is an administration that wants to beat ISIS, beat it badly, beat it up fast. They want to push back hard on Iran. It's not quite clear what that means. Right? But they also don't want to become badly entangled in the region. Now, you want to pick a fight with Iran, best battlefield is Iraq and Kurdistan. And that would be the worst possible thing. It would be the worst possible thing for you. It would be the worst possible thing for us. It would be the worst possible thing for everyone in the region. And so if you are thinking and you're trying to be smart about how do we push back on Iran, we've got to reconcile the tactics with the strategy. How do you push back on Iran, but do it in such a way that you don't wreck Iraq and Kurdistan in the process?
Please, yeah.
I think this is very important in terms of a long-term deliberative strategy. What we haven't talked about at all, and I think the United States hasn't talked about very much at all, is what happens when there's a crisis.
Yeah.
I mean, it's one thing to sit back and to plan and draw your conclusions, but the reality, a very real reality, is this administration could be in a crisis in the next 6 months.
Yeah, I was coming to that.
And nobody has been through one. A lot of people haven't been through one, and even more haven't been through one in the White House.
Yeah. Nabil, you want to do?
Sure. Just one thing that came up in my mind as I was just listening. Actually, Trump did talk a little bit about how he thought we should deal with crisis in the future. And I'm not sure whether the talk scares me or makes me optimistic, because I'm not sure what the detail is. He talked about a Middle East NATO. On the one hand, he talked about it vis-a-vis terrorism. On the other hand, he talked about a little bit about vis-a-vis Iran. So is this a Middle East NATO? In other words, again, does it build up on what I was saying earlier?
Yeah.
You carry the burden and we'll sell you the arms.
Yeah.
That may be one approach. And that would basically mean America withdrawing from the Middle East. Another situation would be, well, he's defining the Middle East now differently. So you bring in, NATO had a strategic alliance. There's no strategic alliance in the Middle East between Arabs and non-Arabs. So how are you going to sort of cover that base as well? So again, I don't think he hasn't thought these things out yet. Let me rephrase that. He's talked about a lot of these things. I'm not sure whether they've been thought out completely yet, though.
Okay.
Thank you.
That's good, because that picks up another point brings out another point that I wanted to talk about. I was reading something, I think it was in Foreign Policy or one of the blob House journals the other day. And it was somebody anonymously talking about state and how state has been hollowed out and there's nobody there and it's in the top corridors. And this anonymous source said it must be like Britain after the Second World War, when the empire had gone. And actually, if you look back, we were busier then than we were in the 1930s, because getting rid of empire and getting rid of leadership is actually as labour intensive, possibly more labour intensive than not getting rid of it or than maintaining it. There's far more things to do. So this is a question which actually John put in my mind earlier about US, this question of leadership. You have to lead if you're leaving as well as if you're staying. Where does this?
But you don't have to lead, and I think that's really an important point. It feels that you do, especially if people's jobs is to engage with the region, then they'll do so. Just like if you hire a staff of generals, they will offer you a military-led strategy because that's what they know. And I think a couple observations based on that in our conversation so far. Number one, I think it's very well-intentioned, but I think we are persisting in being our foreign policy equivalent of those generals and looking for a strategy and a doctrine where one does not exist. And that's a natural thing for us to do. We have data points from Trump, and so we're trying to stitch them together into, call it a doctrine or a strategy or a narrative in the case of us journalists. We're looking for coherence in something that not only isn't, but this is, I think, one of the reasons why throughout the political campaign and also in this very new administration, the surest predictor of Trump has been to actually revert to an analysis based on him rather than an analysis based on his policy positions. And, you know, we're in the realm of psychology, I think, as much as in the realm of foreign policy analysis. And Donald Trump wants to win. And that's why there's an incoherence, I believe, to much of what he has said about the Middle East. He has definite views, and his view about Iraq, by the way, is that it was a terrible mistake. Now, whether he held that view at the time or not is very much unclear. But he not only has said this publicly, he's repeated this privately as well many times, and he believes that the U.S. presence here, the invasion in 2003, was a terrible mistake. He does not want to have his presidency associated in any way with any greater presence here. And he believes, as he said repeatedly, the Iran deal was a terrible deal, the worst deal ever. That doesn't necessarily offer us a view to what he will do as president, because he's interested in being seen as a winning president. And he's a very opportunistic politician. And so that's why he talked about how his son-in-law was going to make peace between the Israelis and the Palestinians. Why? Because he has a long-held strategic view of what that means for the Middle East? No, of course not, because he saw that as something he could potentially accomplish that previous presidents had not. I had a very interesting conversation with someone who's spoken about this directly with Trump on the question of Russia, and why is it that he's consistently talked in these admiring terms about Putin, and also making a deal with Putin that has eluded, in his view, other American presidents, Bill Clinton, George W. Bush, Barack Obama. Arguably, all of those people have failed in their reading of Vladimir Putin, according to Donald Trump. And so this is somewhere where he can be a winner, where he could win. Now, it looks much tougher because of the swirling investigations and the politics of it. It looks tougher to make that reset or that deal with Putin. So you may see Trump opportunistically pull away from it. At any rate, I feel that it's very important for us not to overly attribute motive and strategic thinking to something that I think is not motivated by that. He doesn't care about a grand view of the Middle East. He cares about Trump's presidency.
Yeah, okay. Peter, do you want to comment on that? I'm just interested in this managing incoherence point, because if that's where we end up, who's doing the managing?
Tom Tolles, who's the Washington Post cartoonist, had the best answer, I think, to this question, which is, we're all enrolled in Trump University right now. And which is a short way of saying, who knows? I endorse everything that Susan just said about Trump. I mean, I lived in New York in the late 80s, and sort of, I lived with him then, and he's still the same guy. I think he doesn't have, other than this sort of desire, I mean, at the end of the day, it's about attention. That's what the thing he craves. And winning. I think these are the two most important. It's not going to create a coherent strategy, I don't think. And I think often people like us want to find a strategy anyway, and this is not even about Trump, when one doesn't really exist.
Yeah.
Because human nature is too fallible and too incoherent, and history is too surprising, and strategies it's very rare that people actually have a strategy. It's more that they respond to events as they come along. And you were going to ask a question about the crisis and what happens in this crisis. What crisis are you predicting?
Come on to that. Yeah. John, you just wanted to...
I think the other element, which may be a glimmer of sunlight, is I think the reason that Donald Trump became a reality television star is because he constantly looked at his performance and tried to improve it. And I think he's looking for lessons. He's looking for a sense of what works. I think one of the reasons Steve Bannon is so powerful is Steve Bannon did what everybody said was impossible. And he's earned his stripes. H.R. McMaster, for all that I think probably all of us on this panel have met him in one place or the other, hasn't earned his stripes, hasn't demonstrated to the president personally what he can do. And I think that the other element to include into this is not just does he start off with a strategy. No, clearly he's never thought about a lot of these issues. But he's thought a lot about how do you learn from your performance, how do you get better. I have to say I was appalled at the tweet storm last weekend, which suggested to me he'd learned a lot less than I thought he'd learned. But it does seem to me that he is learning and will learn, and what this administration is in 6 months is going to be a different beast from what it is we're looking at right now.
Thank you. Ken, do you want to?
Yeah, let me get on and maybe help you to transition to the crisis piece, which I think is a critical one, John. I think we're more or less all saying a very similar set of things, which is, first of all, we don't really know how this administration is going to operate and how it's going to make foreign policy, let alone what that foreign policy is going to be. But if you take a number of the different things that we've said, you can imagine different models of how the U.S. is going to handle foreign policy, different scenarios. So at one end, you can imagine the president is mostly going to absorb himself with attacking Arnold Schwarzenegger and, you know, finding out what's going on with Putin and diverting attention from the latest scandal. And he'll mostly leave foreign policy in the hands of his professionals, who will try very hard to lay out reasonable, smart policies, with the exception that every once in a while, the president will suddenly become interested in some foreign policy subject, and he will swoop in and could take the policy 180 degrees in a different direction for some period of time, and then walk away like a tornado and leave them to clean up the mess. That's one model. Another model is that he's actually setting the agenda. Right, and he is constantly saying, we're going to do this and we're going to do that, and all of these smart, able, experienced professionals are going to be constantly playing catch-up with him and trying to make sensible and make smart and make operational everything that he's telling them to do. And that's at a different end, and obviously we can come up with a whole variety of others in the middle. It's the crises that I think are really acute, because either model has its problems. Everything in the middle has its problems, too. This is all going to be about tensions between these. But in a moment of crisis, you absolutely must have leadership. And the leadership must be focused, and the leadership must be experienced, and it must be calm and sensible and ready to consider options and think through them. And so far, we've not yet seen this president demonstrate that ability. And of course, what we know from countless crises through history is, no matter how good your foreign policy team is, no matter how smart your staff is, if the leader isn't capable of dealing with the crisis in that fashion, the staff can't make it up.
So that's a good transition. Thank you. So this is my last sort of question to all of you. And it's about this issue of crisis, winning and losing. If your purpose is to win, what happens when you stop winning? And you know, this is not The Apprentice. You can't say to Iran, "You're fired." It's not going to go. So what do you do? Now, if you have this level of whatever you call it, incoherence, mercurialness in the implementation of policy, or indeed in the implementation of tactical approaches to the Middle East, the odds are that you will get regional players gaming the system, gaming the United States, gaming each other, actually. So you'll actually get this incoherence echoed and amplified in the region. You are also likely to get, as you will get elsewhere, as we've already seen with North Korea, a tests of the United States preparedness, competence, executive competence, and will. We haven't really seen that yet. The Iranians in the past have always managed to tread that line, to walk that line very well. But they've done that partly because they have known what to expect. A lot of the way in which you manage crises in the Middle East is because each side knows what to expect. The danger is when you stop or you misunderstand. And the dangers of this seem to me to be heightened. So what do we think, just thinking about the Middle East, and we might want to include Russia here in the Middle East, what if there were going to be challenges, serious tests of the Trump administration, what do we think they're going to be? Where do we think they're going to come from? And in what sort of areas? I didn't prep this question, actually, so this is I'm asking people to think on their feet. Nabil.
Well, if we're looking at the Middle East, not the world as a whole.
The Middle East.
Probably theater-wise, Syria is the area where there could be the most frequent crisis among, because there's so many different people involved, including Russia and potentially the U.S. So that's a potential area of crisis involving the Russians and the Americans. I don't expect one, but it's an area. It also could involve the Iranians, by the way. The other area is the Gulf. And here is a problem, any sort of friction between American vessels and Iranian vessels. That being said, to go to the core of your question, I can't bet on, let me tell you where I think Trump stands on this. As a businessman, he wants to magnify his profits and limit his losses. These are good instincts. So if you look at it that way, you're not going to do something which is irrational. That being said, given that he doesn't know hardly, well, very much about all these issues, you can ultimately make that mistake with much more propensity than you would if you had a politician who had experience in the area. So it really goes back to my first point. Are we talking about, I mean, look, the president is important. He will always be important. Yep. You cannot underestimate that. That's where the decision is taken. But if this administration becomes coherent, the checks and balances could redirect Trump in a manageable fashion. Mm. If, on the other hand, it's not a coherent administration, then you're going to have large crises and big mistakes.
I mean, here's a plausible crisis. So if on Christmas Day 2009, Al-Qaeda put a bomb on a plane that flew over Detroit, and if it had blown up, would have killed 300 people, and Obama would have been a one-term president. It's not a comment about him, it's a comment about where the American people are on terrorism. And if you look at Obama's presidency, that was one of the most defining moments for him in terms of national security. He suddenly, he didn't want to be the terrorism president and the drone president, and he became it. So what is a plausible thing that could happen is an attack on the United States that was traceable to the Middle East in some fashion, or to Afghanistan or Pakistan. What would Trump do if there was a mass casualty attack? I think you have to assume he'd do something pretty dramatic. So that's unfortunately, I think the likelihood of that happening is pretty low, but it's not out of the question.
Chilling thoughts from Peter. I think it's important to think about this because actually the Miller Center at UVA did a study of presidents' first years in office. And the bottom line is that virtually all modern American presidents have faced not just a crisis, but a fairly significant foreign policy international crisis in their first year in office. And Trump is by no means the first president to be slow off the mark in hiring people for key positions in national security and foreign policy jobs. He is behind where others are because he's having a struggle between these new cabinet officials whose experience we're busy praising and the people in the White House. And there is a genuine tug of war that is unresolved over the extent to which those cabinet secretaries will have the ability to fill these crucial positions. And of course, that just postpones even longer having those jobs empty, the inevitable policy reviews that come as a result of this. Why does it matter? Well, look back at the histories that have been written of September 11th, including by those on this panel. And, you know, you understand they were just getting around to having their first meetings to really look at some crucial issues like counterterrorism policy, even 9 months into the Bush administration. So it matters because the likelihood is very high there will be something like this. Peter's scenario is chilling but plausible. And, you know, for that third reason, I do think it comes back to this question of not attributing greater coherence than actually is the case to Trump's worldview. I think he will be because he prioritizes winning rather than any specific outcome. I believe there will be a degree of ideological flexibility that certainly offers him the chance to course correct in the interest of winning. But it also means that we can't rule out, and I would not rule out, the darker version of Trump's scenario where losing, being boxed into a corner, begets its own escalating series of crises. Because if you look, again, at his biography and his personal life, which is really all we have to go on rather than his foreign policy experience, I would point you to this key period in Donald Trump's life in the late 1980s and early 1990s when his business got in trouble, his personal life got in trouble, he declared bankruptcy, he overextended himself, he made a spiraling series of bad decisions in what amounted to both a personal and business crisis. And that, I think, is a very important period of time in his life. Now, you could say, well, wow, and he managed to pull out of that and become president of the United States. But that didn't happen in 2 years or in the span of a four-year presidential term. So, you know, biography isn't destiny any more than a set of ideological views are. But I think we have to look at it.
Okay.
I think one of his real challenges is my read of Iranian strategy is the Iranians want to isolate the United States and integrate Iran with the rest of the world. And one of the ways to do that is to invite an attack from the United States that the rest of the world thinks is unjustified. It's easier to start one of these things and stop one of these things. And to me, General Flynn's announcing that Iran was formally on notice was a sign that people said, what can we do? And they all kind of shrugged and said, and you come up with words. And there are things you can do. There are absolutely things the United States can do. There's a long list of things you can do. But will they have the desired effect on the Iranians, especially if the Iranian desire is to make you look like an unprincipled bully and to make them look like victims? And I think that, well, General Mattis has very good reasons and a lot of experience to think that when you give the Iranians a very direct message, the Iranians will back off. I worry that there are lots of ways this could play out, which would play to the Iranian advantage and to the American profound disadvantage that will last for several years into the future.
Yeah, good point. Ken?
Yeah, my mind went to the same set of issues that John's did, and I'll phrase it slightly differently, which is, you know, there are crises that are not of your own making. The scenario that Peter painted is something that could happen that would be profound, but that really isn't something that the United States engendered. But an Iran crisis, and I can think of others, could be one of our making, right? Because there's this issue of unintended consequences. Right? We've talked about how Donald Trump, and you all know, Donald Trump very much wants to be a change president. He wants to go in very different directions. And quite frankly, the American people likes that, right? That's why so many Americans voted for him. The problem with change, especially in a place like the Middle East, is it's very complicated here. And once you start moving one part, it starts to affect all kinds of other things that you haven't necessarily thought through. The Iranians are a great example of that. The Iranians have their fingers in a lot of different pies. And rarely for the good of anyone involved. And I can certainly understand the desire to push back on the Iranians, to prevent them from making as much trouble as they had and making the many crises of the region worse. But if you're going to go after the Iranians, you've got to recognize that they do play in all of these different arenas, that they do have the ability to hurt the United States and our allies in a whole range of different ways. And so we can go at them in one area, and they can come at us in a completely different area. And one of the crises of our own making could be that we start to push back on the Iranians in certain areas, and they start to turn up the heat on us in other places where we're simply not expecting it. Right? And so that's why these unintended consequences and the dangers of being a change candidate, even when change is necessary, you've got to be very careful and very thoughtful, and you can't be reckless and make foreign policy by tweet.
Yeah, okay. Sure.
The Iranians and the Americans often play very different games. The Iranians often want influence. They want to be able to make themselves felt. The Americans often are committed to reaching the end point of the resolution. People here in Iraq may feel the U.S. isn't as committed as it needs to be, but I think the U.S. view is, let's look at the objective and stay committed. The Iranians, I think, are often playing a game of denial, which gives them tremendous advantage to do exactly the things Ken was talking about.
Okay. Thank you very much. That was great. I'm going to open this now up to questions. I think we have about 15 minutes, 20 minutes for questions. I'm going to group questions. So I'm going to take three questions at a time and then put them to the panel. And I may feed some of the questions that are coming to me on the web as well. First, can I go to Joseph Mahoud first?
Can we also have some earpieces in case there are people on panel or haven't?
I got nothing.
Thank you. Thank you, John. In fact, my question is mainly to Mrs. Glasser, but anyone can weigh in. In echo to the, analysis of the internal structure, the domestic structure, or the internal structure of the Trump team. If Trump is really eager to be re-elected in 4 years, as we know, doesn't it imply that, in fact, he will be more tempted to follow the foreign policy instincts of what we can call the black cabinet instead of people coming from a more classical Republican tradition like, I mean, McMaster or Matheson, etc., and instead follow the instincts of people like Bannon, Miller, and etc., just because he seeks re-election. And we know that, in fact, I mean, local politics and internal politics is mainly the driver of it.
So I think this is an excellent question and an excellent point. My take would be that, yes, Donald Trump believes that his unlikely election victory, at least in part, was powered by the message and the sort of ideological vision of Steve Bannon, and that it works for him, and that's why he used the phrase radical Islamic terrorism less than 1 week after appointing a national security advisor who made it a test of his own influence within the White House and lost it. Why did he care to repeat that? Not because he has some strategic plan to defeat radical Islamic terrorism, but because he believes it to be good politics with the base. Americans today, as is obvious, are extremely divided along partisan terms. You know, we have a country, we used to talk about the sectarian divisions in Iraq. Well, we have those now in America. They don't happen to be along religious lines, per se, although there's some of that. But, you know, the distinct and increasingly separated worldviews of red America and blue America absolutely have shaped a politics that not only is polarized, but also polarizing. And Donald Trump is not planning to govern as presidents used to from the center, right? The convention was that you maybe ran one way, but that you wanted to get to 51% once you were in office, and you wanted to keep building upon that. He is very much playing a game of play to your base in terms of politics. There is almost a ceiling, right, of around 40% or so who support Donald Trump. It can go lower than that. Maybe there's a hard core of about a third of America. But Donald Trump is never going to be beloved. He'd like to be, but he's not really aiming in his politics to be the president of 55% of America. That's not realistic. And so I agree with your analysis that we're likely to see more inflammatory, rhetoric-driven and politics-driven policies toward the Middle East and other places.
Okay, great. I am going to group questions. So can we have three questions now? Dr. Bahan, you wanted to? Oh, okay. Kamala. So I'm going to try and group questions by proximity because it makes it easy to get the microphone to people.
Okay. Yeah. And I will be brief. You know, we had a lot of discussion here about the dynamics of U.S. military engagement in the region and the reliance of this president so far on uniforms and former uniforms as senior advisors. So given what a number of you have said about the dangers of over-militarization, and we've heard a lot about that over the last couple of days, over-militarization of the region's problems, it's a question for you, Nabil, which is, what more do you think regional governments can offer this White House or can say to this White House on the non-military side? Thanks.
Okay, thanks. Clarice Pastori? And then we'll take the gentleman there.
Actually, not entirely unsimilar question. Can you assert, obviously, that there
Could you stand up?
You said there is a need, obviously, for a political, economic, and social strategy post-Daesh for Iraq. And then I think it was John Alterman who said U.S. would engage, but not alone, and not over-engage, I think was your words. And John, you talked about gaming. So similar to your question, Tamara, my question for Iraq in particular is, can we deduct from that this might be a good time to think about like Iraq Compact 2? A kind of compact thing again, if you remember the old one. So it's sort of a joint, more regional, other big actors, Europe, Gulf, US, political, military, economic, social, broader conditionalities, etc. Thank you.
So there's a question about regional, whether regional, what they do to help themselves and what they do to help Trump administration. Gentleman there, then Georgie, and then we'll...
Spas. طبعا ما قال لك ان بدرجاي ميشو خباتي زور ما كردو بو ازادي وسر بخوي لا هاو كشي نيو تيجا بو برنگار بنوي تيرور براسي سلمات مان كهزكي كاري كرين و گلی کیم رو دوست و آشتی خوازی مراسی. استا اراده گل هی با سر بخوی. پالپش و میساقی نتویر بگوان و بلگنامه سیاسی و کمالایتی و روشنبری سالی 1966 ام سروک جاوازی امریکا مفروض وای چی سیاست و حلوستی که هبه با ملتی که خواستی با سر بخویی هست. آیا هر سیاست کتکی جارانه که لگه قیادت سیاسی کرد دا انیشونوم پیمان خوش سر بخوابن و سر بخوابن یا مفروض وای حلوستی که جاوست رو رونتری هبه. سپاس.
Okay, I missed half of that question, I'm afraid, Okay, thanks. No, Georgi, there.
Thank you very much, Georgi Bustin from the United Nations. My very brief question. Considering that there will be a U.S. strategy on the Middle East and particularly on Iraq, will the U.S. want to go it alone, or will the U.S. look for allies, and particularly will the U.S. look for the United Nations? Thank you.
Okay, so there are quite a lot of questions about a balance between what the U.S. does and what regional states do, and what regional states can offer to make this better. Maybe, Nabil, start with.
Sure. Again, even back home when I speak to Arab audiences, before Trump and now even more after Trump, I keep saying, the world is changing. We need to depend on ourselves much more nationally and then regionally in the Arab world, and we go on. The imbalances that exist in the Arab world have caused a lot of the national security imbalances and consequently the influence of non-Arab states at the expense of Arab states. So the only reason I said that Trump's election is an opportunity is it should help Arabs think in real terms. You need to do things differently. You can't simply depend on America or the West to carry an irrational portion of the responsibility. It does not mean move away from the U.S., it doesn't mean cut off relations, but definitely to deal with non-existential threats, Arabs have to be more capable to do that. But the question, Tamara's question was not only militarily. My first answer is national security capacity has to be enhanced in the Arab world. But beyond that, well, we need to speak more clearly. What is a progressive modern Arab state in the 21st century? Not to Trump, to each other, to our own people and to each other. Okay, how do we get there? I like the concept, the Arab world. I look at that geographically, not necessarily only as states. And there are the majority, overwhelmingly, is Arab, but there are non-Arabs in the Arab world. They're still part of the Arab world. So how do we find a balance that makes everybody not equally happy, but reasonably happy? So I would go to Trump and say, look, this is how I see I want to do things. Can you help us on this? I'm going to do A, B, C, and D, but I need your help on these things. He may agree to some of them and may not agree to the other. If we go to him and tell him, you carry the ball, we're going to come back with an empty basket. If we show them we can carry a bit more of the responsibility, I think there's room to work there. Thank you.
Thanks. Ken, Kurdish independence.
Absolutely. And here I need to be careful. I think this is well known in Kurdistan. I am a staunch advocate of Kurdish independence. And I believe that because it is in the interest of the United States of America, not just because you have legitimate national aspirations. But you asked me a different question. You asked me, can this administration support it? Can they act instead of and not just speak? As always, I have to be careful. We don't know yet. This administration has not formulated its policy toward Iraq, toward Kurdistan. As you've heard other members of the panel discuss, the president himself has no particular commitment to this part of the world. Susan made that point in particular. The members of his national security cabinet do have that kind of a commitment. But I think, if I can put this briefly but bluntly, I think what this team is going to be looking for is how much is Kurdistan willing to help itself, and how much is it going to ask from the United States? If Kurdistan is willing to help itself, and there are some specific things that I think this administration will be looking for, yes, I think that this administration certainly will be willing to consider, and I hope embrace the idea of Kurdish independence. What will they be looking for? First, I think that they will be looking for continued reform. I think that the reform program that has been begun under Kaknesheva and Kakubad is critically important to Americans. We want to see Kurdistan becoming something different from every other country in the region. As Americans, that is something that we love, that is something that we can support. I think that we're going to want to see a degree of political unity here. No, you don't have to be in lockstep, but you can't be at each other's throats either. And beyond that, Kurdish independence cannot come at the expense of Iraq's stability. I know that that is a hard thing for all of you to hear, but I think that that will be very important to the members of this administration who fought in Iraq. For them, Iraq is critically important. They are terrified that they are losing Baghdad to Iran. And while they certainly love the Kurds, they respect the sacrifices made by the Kurdish people and the Peshmerga, something that we should all always be grateful to all of you for. And I add my thanks to that, hopefully, eventually, of my government. There is a very strong fear of doing anything that could destabilize Baghdad. And what that means, ultimately, is simply having a process. Kurdish independence cannot come as simply a unilateral action that upsets the apple cart. It needs to be part of a process of negotiation with Baghdad, with the neighbors, to make sure that it happens peacefully. Under those circumstances, yes, I think that there is an excellent prospect that this administration could back it.
Thanks, Ken. We are pressed for time, I'm afraid. So I have one more set of questions, which I'm going to take from the questions which people took the trouble to email in. And this is a set of questions which speaks to the issue of the president's domestic constituency in the US. So I'll read these out. The first one is from Rashid. Why do you think Trump backtracked on his travel ban policy and took Iraq out? The second one is from Shad. Trump's view of the world is scary, but is that his will or the Americans in general? The third one is from Nasebi Yunus, which is, what would Trump do if there was a terrorist attack in the US, which you partly addressed, but this is interesting in this context. Could react dramatically with great damage. The fourth one is from Hadi Karim. Trump's travel ban excluded many countries with high terrorism rates, such as Saudi Arabia. Could this policy be only a show to his voters that he keeps his promises? These all sort of revolve around the issue of the dialectic, as it were, between the president, his decisions, and his constituency. And as far as the last time I looked at the figures, his decisions on various things, including the travel ban, were still quite popular. So how does that work in terms of actually thinking about what the president and his team will do? Is he going to be looking over his shoulder at how this plays in the American heartland? And what are the things that he's going to be looking for in particular, and what would shift the way that they react? And perhaps I can ask Peter, Susan, and John to comment on this.
Yeah, I wanted to go back to Kurdistan. Sorry. I mean, I first came to Iraq in 2008 with Ken, and I've never been to Kurdistan. And this is an open, safe, and organized society. And we're talking about what does a progressive entity look like in the Middle East. And I have a suggestion, Dr. Barham, which is invite Donald Trump to come here for the next Suli Forum. Because, I mean, there's nothing like seeing it for yourself. And on the military question that Tamara had, I think it is an oversimplification to think that the military guys are going to have military policies. In fact, it was General Mattis who said, look, if we reduce the State Department, then I'm going to have to buy more ammunition. So the people who understand that the most are the military guys. And there's a very long tradition in the United States, and just look at General Dempsey, who was very skeptical about sending troops into Iraq, of the military being the least inclined to use military power because they know what it looks like. So I would be very careful with the idea that somehow there's going to be a militarization of policy because military folks are in positions of importance. I think they'll be the main people saying, well, what does day two look like? What does the day after look like?
Okay, so perhaps you could answer the...
No, I'll answer your questions if you want.
Okay.
What did you ask, Peter?
I'm going to ask both of you.
All right.
Answer the question.
No, I think, look, the first thing is the president wants to demonstrate he's decisive. He loves showing he's decisive, right? I mean, that's, I think, his television persona. That's what he demonstrated on the campaign trail. The president wants to show that he's decisive. He's going to do things that are decisive and let other people work out the details, that's, he's an executive, he does the strategic stuff, he makes decisions. So I think that's part of what explains the travel ban, part of what explains a lot of his strategies. He wants to be the decider. I think in terms of the American public, there are two things going on. One is, yeah, there are some Americans really hostile toward the Middle East for all kinds of reasons, some of which it's religiously based, and they say that people in the Middle East want to impose Sharia law in the United States, right? I mean, you have a group of people like that. I think you have a group of people who are still angry about 9/11, you have a whole series of things. But there's another group, which I think is probably what tips this, people who are just tired of the Middle East. They say, you know what? We put $1 trillion into Iraq and Afghanistan. We keep trying to do things. We're trying to do this Arab-Israeli stuff. We keep putting money into that and billions of dollars and billions of dollars and billions of dollars. And what it engenders is more people from the Middle East asking us for more stuff. The fact is we have unconventional oil and gas. We have energy independence. We need to take care of ourselves instead of pouring money for a bunch of ungrateful people who take money and then just ask us for more. I think the foreign policy blob, which we are all, I think, card-carrying members of, has a view that energy is a global commodity and we have an interdependence. And you know, you can say that you want to rebalance toward Asia, but Asia gets 80% of its oil and gas from the Middle East, and Asia cares a lot about Middle Eastern security. If you're going to invest in Asia, you have to also stay invested in the Middle East. That's, you know, a question, that's an answer that most Americans have no interest or patience with. Right. The other thing is, why are we sending our kids to fight and die? Why are we spending billions of dollars and billions of dollars and billions of dollars? Let's take care of ourselves. And it's not so much hostility. It's just fatigue that we keep investing in the perception of many Americans, and we've yet to see a return.
Yeah. Well, so can I just say, I totally agree with what you're saying as far as the overall politics of this in the U.S. However, I think you're wrong on just one thing. I think it is hostility on Donald Trump's part. He has a personal and well-documented aversion and a willingness to use very racially tinged rhetoric. And remember, the reason and the way in which he entered our national politics was through accusing the President of the United States of not having been born in the United States and of secretly being a Muslim. So let's not forget that. And I think it's really important because, in fact, Donald Trump is not the view that you ascribe to Americans, I think, is widely held. And in fact, you could largely say it was a conversation opened up by Barack Obama. And, you know, Peter made this point as well, that there is some continuity because there's some continuity in the views of the American people, which is to say a fatigue with what they view as the sort of quagmire and the black hole of the Middle East when it comes to our resources and why we're here and what the return on those investments are, right? So that's something that has a sort of broad bipartisan view. However, I think in the case of Trump and many of those that with whom he surrounded himself, it fuses with views of an altogether different sort, ones that would have been anathema to the Obama administration, and that in fact, you know, that's where the uncertainty comes in, is that we don't know just where they're going to take that part of their views, which is that we are in a civilizational and generational conflict with an ideology that comes from this place. And that is the view not only of the president's closest advisor, the guy who he believes won him the election to the presidency, Steve Bannon, it is also in some way the president's view. We don't know how much he's going to act on it or not, but I do think it's risky to discount that simply because it sounds like a lot of positioning for domestic purposes, because it is something fundamentally different than the view espoused by Barack Obama, or I think of most Americans, at least at this point.
Thank you very much. I'm afraid that is all we have time for. So I apologize profusely to all those whose questions I couldn't take. I know there were a lot of questions because we had a fantastic discussion here. And I want to thank Kak Barham and Christine Mendenhall and indeed the staff of AIIS for allowing us to have this quality of discussion. I can't say we have solved everything, but we have spoken with great clarity about the things
basically
that need to be solved. So thank you again, and thank you to our excellent panel for doing all this. Thank you very much.